Praise the name of the Lord. Praise Him, all you servants of the Lord. You who stand in the house of the Lord, in the courts of the house of our God. Praise the Lord, for the Lord is good. Sing praises to His name, for it is blessed. Let's give God in prayer. Almighty gracious God, we bow down before you this morning, giving you thanks for the gift of life, gift of worship, the gift of fellowship, gift of being the Lord, children of God, gift of eternal life. What can we give in return, Lord? We are eternally indebted to this love. We bring ourselves, body, mind, and spirit, and we lay them before the altar. Accept our offering, Lord, for we are the offering. Father, we pray that our worship will be acceptable in your sight. Holy Spirit, minister amongst us. Touch us in a very personal way. Through this service, we want to fall in love with Jesus more and more. We love you. We praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us stand and sing hymn number 160 as the opening hymn. Praise my soul, the King of Heaven. Hymn number 160. Lord. Hallelujah. Praise be to God. He has given us life. He has given us this privilege to worship. It's my joy to welcome every one of you in the name of Jesus this morning service to take time to greet one another.
Of things that we have, and yet our first time. We'd like to welcome you. We would like to honor your presence. So would you please stand if you are here for the first time? Thank you. Welcome to our church. And to meet you,
Today we are glad to have Beni Prasad with us.
He is a missionary with Vaibhav.
He's traveled to seven nations.
I wonder how his passport looks like.
So if you know anyone who is in the Tamil Fellowship,
This evening we'll have God's Word to us. Next Sunday, the evening service, Holy Covenant service at 6 p.m.
We have the special collection for the service that we think of evangelism.
The medical gospel and counseling program on the 21st, that is next Sunday, service will be at SMW from 11 a.m. till 3 p.m. So those who would like to join, please register, and we'll have the vehicle leave the campus at 10:45. So please remember this and do join us. We have a wonderful time of ministering to people in the different outreach locations every month. And so this is one such occasion where the outreach is very close to where we are. The Kirk Summer Bible School will start on the 24th of April and the final day will be on the 5th of May. So if you'd like to register your children or other young people who you know, please do so. You can actually click on the WhatsApp
announcement link
and register online. If you'd like to do it in person, you can contact us.
The Bible quiz, as we've been announcing, will be on the 9th of June
at 11:30 a.m. Sunday.
So do prepare the various segments for different age groups in the announcement sheet, it's also out there. This morning our choir will present a special music title, Come Let Us Sing. And so this time I also like to acknowledge the service that has been rendered by our choir, the organist, and the choir director. Can we show our appreciation to the choir?
When you came in, you may have seen the seating arrangements are a little different, and this is to do with the restoration work.
Now you'll see a video come up, and it's just a small snapshot of what happens in restoring one part of the pillar. And so, as you watch this, you also see that it is painstaking work, and it is done by very skilled labor, very special skilled labor. And that process takes a long time, and it's also very expensive. So once the work is done, it takes about 20 minutes for full curing. That's because of the composition of the material. And so this means that the work that has been done should not be disturbed. It's very difficult to do this in a building where we have various events. So I just want to request each one of you, wherever the work is being done, on the pillars and even in the periphery, please be very careful not to touch, or even when you move the chairs, which is why the single chairs are not removed. But even the pews, when you get off, please be aware that work is happening on the pillars as well as the periphery areas. So please do not touch those. If you notice in the video,
You want to declare it in writing to the Municipal Church
This is the second time of asking. There is a purpose of marriage between Jeshua Chinnapan Edward, bachelor and member of the TNC Antimadar Church in Kannada, son of Mr. and Mrs. Edward J. C. Kennedy, and Sharon Rachel, spinster and member of the TNC Antimadar Church, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Simon Solomon, of which a proclamation is here by name. If anyone knows why these two persons should not be joined in marriage, you are to declare it in writing with the minister of this church. This is the second time of asking. There is a purpose of marriage between Ashwin Prabhakar, bachelor and member of the Apostolic Fellowship Tabernacle, son of Mr. and Mrs. Prabhakar and Birmal, and Sharon Nazini, spinster and member of the New Life Assembly of God Church, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. A. Nazini, of which a proclamation is hereby made. If anyone knows why these two persons should not be joined in marriage, you are to declare it in writing to the minister of this church. This is the first time of asking. Let us do God in prayer.
Praise you for this blessed opportunity that we could pray for one another, lifting our brothers and sisters before the throne of grace, knowing, O Lord, that you are the giver of life. You, O Lord, want to be the shepherd of our lives, and we gladly want to be the sheep who listen and follow the shepherd's voice. Father, we thank you for each one who are celebrating their birthdays and wedding anniversaries this day and this week. We pray, O Lord, that goodness and mercy will follow them all the days of their life. We pray that they, O Lord, will walk into the new year with a heart of gratitude, that they would make a commitment, Lord, to obey and glorify you through their lives. Fulfill the desires of their heart. May their number one desire be to love and follow Jesus. We pray, O Lord, for Sam and Sharon, for Jeshua and Sharon Rachel, for Ashwin and Sharon Nazir. We pray, God, that you would bless and guide these young people preparing for marriage, that they, O Lord, will make a commitment to you before entering into a covenant relationship. Father, we pray that you would be glorified through their lives. We love you. We praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. The Bible says, do not hinder the little children from coming to me. And it's our joy to have the dedication of a child during COVID and beyond. We did that as a separate service, but we want to have it as part of the service today. So I'm going to call Vijay and Sucharita to bring their child forward, and the words for the dedication will be on the screen. You can follow along. Vijay and Sucharita have brought Ivan Peter Selvarajan before us today to publicly dedicate him to the Lord. Jesus said, let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Family is a divine institution ordained of God from the beginning of time. Children are a heritage of the Lord committed by God to their parents for care, provision, protection, and spiritual training. It is good when parents recognize all of these obligations and responsibilities and make every effort to fully carry them out. In this act of dedication, Vijay and Sucharita acknowledge these responsibilities and come before us today to dedicate themselves and Ivan Peter Selvarajan to God and to his will for their lives as a family. The primary responsibility for the care of Ivan Peter Selvarajan rests on the parents, Vijay and Sucharita. The scripture says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Ephesians 6:4 says, bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. And in Deuteronomy 6 we read, these commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you lie when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Vijay and Sucharita, as you engage in this task with joy and peace, may you earnestly seek the Lord daily for His wisdom, for all the events that will occur, all the decisions to be made, and all the needs to be met. For as James says, if any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. May you also give thanks to God for your children and for the joy and love they bring to your home. And as they grow, may you earnestly strive to spend adequate time with them and nurture them. So Vijay and Sucharita, if it be your intention to present your child and your children to the Lord and to pledge yourselves to bring your children up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord, please respond appropriately to the following promises. Do you hereby this day recognize your child as a gift of God and give heartfelt thanks for God's blessings?
We do.
Do you hereby this day dedicate your child to the Lord who gave him to you?
We do.
Will you accept your God-given responsibility to raise Ivan Peter Selvarajan in a Christ-centered home? Will you teach and discipline him in your home so that you are not solely dependent on the church or school system to impart biblical knowledge and spiritual values to him?
We will.
Do you promise early seek to lead him to accept Jesus Christ as Savior and serve him as his Lord?
We will.
Vijay, as his earthly father, will you give Ivan Peter Selvarajan the time, attention and affection that show the true nature of his Father in heaven?
I will.
Sucharita, as his earthly mother, will you give Ivan Peter Selvarajan the special attachment he would crave from you and the special nurturing touch that you are uniquely gifted by God to give him?
I will.
Now ask the congregation to please stand. Dear church, it is your responsibility to provide a caring, supportive group for this family. I ask you to be faithful in prayer for them and support their efforts to establish a strong Christian home built on Christian principles. And I charge you to covenant before God to set an example by your lives and to maintain an atmosphere which will inspire Ivan Peter Selvarajan to desire the Christian way of life. So I'm waiting for a response from the congregation. Will you, members of this congregation who have accepted Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, be faithful to your calling as members of the body of Christ so that this child and all these children and all other children in our midst may grow up in the knowledge and love of God? We're going to ask the parents to pray a prayer, after which I will receive and dedicate.
Lord Jesus, we present our child, Ivan Peter Selvarajan, to you, believing in your loving care and with the prayer that he would respond to the work of your Spirit to bring him to trust in you as his Lord and Savior.
Okay. Yeah, hold the child, please. May I ask every child of God, believer, to raise your right hand towards this family and this child in particular. And now, on the authority of God's holy word, and as a minister of Christ's church, I dedicate you, Ivan Peter Selvarajan, unto the Lord and unto his service, according to his will, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And all of God's people said, Amen. God bless. I'm so glad he is quiet and sleeping. Congregation, please be seated.
Support me, pray. Every child grows up in this world, they will be safeguarded, their hearts, their minds, their will.
because the generation is dark, the world is darker, and only Jesus can redeem, save, and bless and use it. We're going to listen to the anthems by the choir. We thank God for the church, the choir, always a blessing, and we have a special one today over to the choir.
He disobeyed God, and a chasm was created between sinful man and his holy creator. A chasm that could only be bridged by God, the Savior.
Thank you.
He sent his own Son, Jesus, to die on the cross, to die in our place so that we, undeserving as we are, might be saved by the simple act of believing in him and accepting him as our Lord and Savior. And we can only marvel at his sacrifice and raise our voices in gratitude for what has been done.
Thank you, choir. Can we put our hands together one more time? I was just telling Brother Benny, we've got the best seat in the house, able to hear that beautiful. We're going to stand and join the choir and sing hymn number 122. Let all the world, hymn number 122.
Please be seated. Sorry, we're going to read the Bible. Please stay standing. Good morning. Hear the word of God as it is written in the book of James, chapter 5, verses 17 and 18. The book of James, chapter 5, verses 17 and 18. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours. And he prayed earnestly that it would not rain. And it did not rain on the land for 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth produced its fruit. Here ends the lesson. Praise be to God.
Please be seated. I really want to appreciate the choir. Just so much of hard work has gone into that. And as a musician, I was just listening to those notes. They were just going everywhere. And they were still able to follow. And it's a lot of work, really a lot of work. And it's done with a big heart, voluntarily. And they really need a lot more encouragement and appreciation. And if you ever see them, just greet them and thank them for the blessing that they could be to us. I remember when I was doing my School of Music and Missions in New Mexico in 1999, I went to an Episcopalian church, Episcopal church or Episcopalian one, and the choir was just so good that I could not finish singing one hymn in those 3 months without tears in my eyes. And later on when I went and spoke to the choir director as well as the choir, it was all their, it was their heart and their hard work that they went. 3 times a week they used to gather, practice, so that they could give their best. And we thank God for the ministry of music in this church. And before I share from the word, Please watch this short video and then we will move forward.
We commence our day with a 15-minute workout at 6:30 a.m. I'm delighted that physical fitness is a part of our lifestyle here.
I've been a flight attendant for past 10 years and I never had a disciplined quiet time. And even when I had one, I never took down notes. After joining ADTS, I've learned to have a disciplined and structured quiet time, taking notes as the Lord speaks to me on a daily basis.
As a medical doctor, I struggled to believe the Bible as God's inspired word. I chose what to believe and ignored the rest of the Bible. The ADDS taught me about historical and external evidences supporting the Bible's events, which enhanced my belief that God inspired it.
We have amazing teachers who have a lot of practical experience. The beauty of the lectures is that it's not just about the content, but also the practical approach of how we can apply it.
My character and lifestyle in the corporate world were indiscipline. Coming here has improved my time management and moral discipline. I used to spend 8 to 10 hours on social media daily. Now, I barely spend an hour on my days off.
The gospel and salvation are essential for all individuals, regardless of their socio-economic status or level of education. Amidst the complexities of urban life, the gospel provides healing, reconciliation, and a path to abundant life. Here at the Apologetics DTS, we empower people from the marketplaces who have taken 5 months off from their lucrative careers to get equipped intellectually and rationally and to reason things out and defend their beliefs.
Having taught in every ADTS batch, I can attest that the training convinces participants that their jobs are equally important as church leadership. I see this as a valuable investment, fostering the perspective among young Christian professionals that their job is a calling from God. I strongly urge every Christian in the workplace to consider doing the ADTS.
Every afternoon, we have a dedicated time of more than an hour of question and answers with our teachers. It is indeed one of the highlights of ADTS.
The majority of the time, after a while, we forget what we learned in class. On the other hand, we have evening mock debates that provide an organized environment where students may practice their arguments, develop their critical thinking abilities, and learn empathy by role-playing hypothetical situations.
I've struggled with procrastination and poor time management. Joining the ADTS with its emphasis on time management assisted me in valuing others and praising God. Benny's phrase, "Here we go by seconds and not by minutes," continues to ring true to this day. Thanks to the ADTS, I can juggle work and other obligations.
Every Saturday at 4:30 p.m., we host an open mic session that supports artistic expressions and conversations with the local community. This relational approach stimulates sharing personal experiences in order to inspire faith through meaningful conversations.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, we can stop it. Yeah. So this is one of the things that God has called me to do, is to equip people from the marketplace. And because it's so important for us to share the gospel to everyone. You know, anyone who does not have Jesus is an unreached person. And if there's anyone who's keen in getting equipped, please come and talk to me at the end of the service. It's a brilliant course for 3 months. This morning, I'm going to talk on fervent prayer. As you have read from the scripture reading, once again, I want to focus. If you have your Bibles, please turn your Bibles to James chapter 5, verse 17. If you don't have a Bible, sit next to a Christian will carry a Bible. Elijah was a human being, even as we are. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. The first thing, James says Elijah was a human being just like you and I. That is a shocking statement. For a hero like Elijah, you would call him ordinary. No, today you see, you achieve a little bit, you're already considered with titles. You know, like Sachin Tendulkar is not playing cricket anymore, but he's still considered as the great Sachin Tendulkar. Or Neeraj Chopra, the javelin thrower. You know, he's considered as the great javelin thrower. Or Usain Bolt, the runner, still considered as the great. And Elijah has done so many incredible things, and he is considered as an ordinary person according to James. Why? Why did James call him ordinary when he has done extraordinary things in life? And I was trying to look at Elijah, the way he ran. And it was amazing that nobody has run like him before. And I don't think even in the future it is possible to run like him. Because the distance from Mount Carmel to Jezreel is around 27 kilometers. A half marathon is about 21 kilometers. If you have to calculate Usain Bolt, the speed he ran for a half marathon, he would have done at a pace of 45 kilometers an hour. The fastest recorded speed of a chariot is 55 kilometers an hour. And Abraham Kiptum, who has the world record for the fastest half marathon runner, he did that in 58 minutes and 18 seconds. And the Bible says Elijah outran the chariot, which means Elijah would have done 27 kilometers in about 27 minutes. Humanly, it is impossible. And if that is what Elijah did, and you call him ordinary, there is a problem in our modern day understanding. How can you call somebody ordinary when he has achieved so much? The book of James is a letter written by James, and James was the leader of the Jerusalem church. And he wrote this letter to encourage the scattered Jewish Christians who got scattered because of persecution. So the entire book, the background is James, as the leader of the Jerusalem church, he is writing this letter to encourage the scattered Jewish Christians. Now, contrary to James, there were other Jewish writers who wrote saying that Elijah was not an ordinary human being. In fact, Elijah was not even born of humankind. He was born of an angel, and Elijah was one who was clothed with four elements of the world, that is earth, water, air, and fire. That's why Elijah could do these extraordinary things. That is what the other writers were telling. And James is refuting that, and he is telling that Elijah is an ordinary human being just like you and I, which means he was born to earthly parents. He was born with sinful nature. He had every tendency to fall short of God's glory like any one of us. And yet, he fervently prayed that it would not rain for 3.5 years, and it did not. And then he prayed, and it rained, and the earth produced its crops. Now, the whole thing about fervent prayer. To understand the background, I would encourage you to go back home and read from 1 Kings chapter 17 and 18, and you would understand why did Elijah pray a prayer like this. Somebody said this: prayer is effective not because of great men and women who pray, but because of a great God who graciously hears his children. You see, the greatness of our prayers being answered is not about a man or woman. It is about God. We need to make sure that the credit and the glory goes to God, but it's not happening like that. Today we are outsourcing prayers. No, we give money and we tell, please pray for me, please pray for me, please pray for me. We don't pray, but we have faith over other people praying. Same thing even in the church. If the junior pastor prays, that's not enough. The senior pastor has to pray. And same thing with falling. You know, sometimes, you know, you fall, if God does something, that's fine. But we don't need to help God. And I'm there, I'm praying, and already there in that, just in that swing position, you know. So just stand straight, please. They think that only when they fall, God has done something. But, you know, we don't need to do all of that drama. We don't need to hold people in a special position that if they pray, God will answer. No. All of us who are disciples of Jesus Christ, followers of Jesus Christ, we are a royal priesthood. We are a holy nation. We are a people belonging to God. So it is important for us to believe and have faith that when I pray, Jesus Christ, who is the same yesterday and today and forever, will answer my prayer. Do you have faith that God will answer your prayer? But you know what's happened today? There are small little Jesuses that we have made out of the men and women in our lives. We are so quick in calling them and say, pray for me, pray for me, pray for me. But do you pray? Do you have faith that God can answer you? It is so important, dear friends, that we understand that the fervency in our prayer is important in our lives rather than counting on somebody else. And today with money, we have been very quick in outsourcing. We outsource things. No! Faith is part of your journey. It is part of your spiritual journey. And it is amazing to adventure with God even through your prayers. It is so important. You know, reciting repeated words is the reverse of fervent prayer. Reciting repeated words, and it's become a trend today. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. God, do come, Lord, come, Lord, come, Lord. You can tell him once, he will understand that. But you know what is happening? When you do these repeated forms of things, our mind is absent. And as a result, I can keep praying, God, do something, do something, do something, and I can keep checking my pan flute because my mind is not. That's why when you pray, let your mind and your heart be active. Do it together. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And it is important, and we can enjoy the life of Elijah in our own lives when we fervently pray. You know, the definition of fervent in Cambridge English Dictionary is displaying a passionate intensity, burning or glowing. To put it simply, to do anything fiercely means to do it with a great deal of enthusiasm. That is what the word fervent is. Collins Dictionary says, a fervent person has or shows strong feelings about something and is very sincere and enthusiastic about it. When you pray, do you show a passionate intensity in your prayer? Or are you just saying, God, do something? God, just come up, do something. But you know, when you are in that situation, the way you pray is different. I was telling in the previous service, I remember when I was invited to North Korea by the government, and I was an official representation of India, and they gave me a one-way ticket. They said, please come over, and after your 1 week, we will give you a return ticket. And I was all excited, representing India, invited by the government, first time officially going. And I landed there 1 week. Now I'm ready to come back, but I don't have a ticket. And the government says, the official says, can you stay for another 3 days? I said, no, my contract with you is for 7 days and I'm done with it. I want to go home. I have other commitments. They said, no, you have to stay for 3 days. What do I do? Nothing. And I'm completely cut off from the world. I have no communication with anybody. Cell phones are taken off at the airport. Even if you have, it will not work there. And what do you do in this situation? I fervently prayed. I prayed that night. I said, God, please do a miracle. Please come, Lord, do something. The next day morning, the official came with the flight ticket and he said, you can go tomorrow. No, that is where you are displaying a passionate intensity. You're not just going to go lie down on a comfortable sofa with the AC blowing on you and saying, God, do something, Lord. No, but you are putting your entire energy into that one. Same thing when I was in Afghanistan. My friend came to pick me up from the airport in Kabul. He's driving me and suddenly he started to just go here and there, driving crazy. And I told him, brother, what happened? He said, you know what? There is a death penalty on me by the Taliban. And I could see them following me. So that's why I had to choose different roads. He's been there for 25 years as a missionary. When he's driving, you're not just going to enjoy the joyride. You are fervently praying, passionately praying, praying that God would protect you, praying that God would blind these terrorists. You know, that is where it is. So when you pray fervently. You pray with a passionate intensity. And that's what Elijah did. And that's why his prayers really worked. And today I want to just bring few highlights from his life and also bring it from my own life. You know, I'm a storyteller that way. First thing, why Elijah's prayers worked and why our prayers don't work is because Elijah learned to wholly rely on God. Elijah learned to wholly rely on God. Nobody else for him. It was just God and God alone. There was no plan B, no plan C. In 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 5 and 6, Elijah did as the Lord told him and camped beside Kiriath Brook, east of the Jordan. The ravens brought him bread and meat each morning and evening, and he drank from the brook. That is what Elijah did. He was at a place where there was no food, nobody, not a soul. And he could have easily died out of starvation. But he wholly relied on God, and he did as the Lord told. And the most unlikely bird, a raven. Raven is also non-vegetarian. And the raven brought him meat every morning and every evening, both meat and bread. And Elijah learned to wholly rely on God. Do we have that patience to rely on God? Somebody said, time spent waiting on God is never wasted. We never waste time in waiting in the presence of God, even though it is difficult. And today we have so many options, so many different ways for us that are waiting, even in the church today. When we say, let's have a minute of silence and ponder, it's difficult. The guitarist can't keep quiet. Within 10 seconds, he has to strum something. The pianist has to play something. There's some noise has to happen. It is difficult for us to remain quiet in the presence of God. But I'll tell you, Elijah learned to wholly rely on God, and as a result, he could see this amazing provision from the Lord. Are you trying to help God? There are times where we threaten God. We say, God, I'm going to give you 3 days time limit. In 3 days, if you can do it, I will praise you. I will give 20% of my tithe. I'll do all these things. But if you don't do in 3 days time, I'm going to stop going to church. You know, we threaten God. We are blackmailing God sometimes. But he is God, is sovereign. Let us learn to wholly rely on him. When I look at my own life, you know, for me, wholly relying on God came with my travels. I still remember when I came to Chennai first time for my visa to UK, 1996. I'd applied for a UK visa. Twice I was rejected. I didn't even have a bank account. And they said, what's the proof you'll come back? I said, please trust me. That does not work in the embassy. They're not going to trust you. They want evidence. And here, I grew up, my travel stories, I grew up with rejection. In fact, recently I wrote a book about a year ago called Unthinkable. And I put these stories into the book, talking. And for me, a lot of memories came back about my journey. But in 2001 or two, God gave me the vision to travel to every country in the world. You can show the world map on the screen, please. And every time people remember me for few reasons, and one of them is my passport. So even this morning, brother reminded me of the passport. Pastor said, did you bring your passport? So I'm one of those passport-carrying church-going Christians here. So this is my passport. It's a combination of about 16 books inside. The proof of how I went to every single country on this earth, 257 countries. But the question comes is, how did you do it? I'm a YWAM missionary. I've learned to live by faith. No salary, no borrowing money, no asking money, no trusting the credit card, nothing. I said, God, you want me to travel? I will be your traveler. I made this commitment with Jesus that I will wholly rely on you. I will never ask for money, will never borrow money, will never take a loan from the bank or trust the credit card. And I took that step. And the journey was not easy. My first country was Russia as a musician. And I was detained in Russia for 30 hours for refusing to pay a bribe of $50. And after 30 hours, I was deported back to India. You can read that in the book, the episode of what happened. But I still learned to wholly rely on God, even in the midst of failures and defeats and delays. And what God did was amazing. Today, even though I broke the world record 10 years ago, people still ask me, how did you do this? How did you achieve this? How could you travel to 257 countries? The visas, the flight tickets, safety, contacts. It is nothing but purely, wholly relying on God. I challenge you, friends, if there's anyone going through this dark time in life, uncertain times, you feel like everything is falling apart, you can still learn to wholly rely on God. After my travels, God told me to build a center called Chai 316. Again, the challenge was, where will I get the money? Now, this is the building of this place. And God told me, go and buy a piece of land. I said, God, land and flight ticket is two different prices. You see, sometimes we try to update God with our latest situation. I'm like a fool. I'm telling God, the price of the ticket and the land is two different values. But for God, He owns the universe. He owns a cattle on a thousand hills. He owns everything. He said, I will provide for you. Go. And it was a miracle that God provided. But he told me, go and empty your bank account. When I emptied, I was shocked that there was 1 crore rupees in my account. I took that. The land was 1.5 crores. I sat down with the landowner at a cafe coffee day. And I gave him the check for 1 crore. He was shocked. He said, where did you get so much money? I see you traveling in the bus to the airport. You have a scooter. How did you get so much money? I told him the 13 years of my travels. This is what God did and He provided. I did not know that there was so much, but I still needed 50 lakhs. He looked at me and he says, Benny, your story is so inspiring. Only Jesus can do something like that in your life. I said, yes, Francis. And he took a sip of coffee. And then he said, the rest of the 50 lakhs is my investment back into your ministry. And it was just, for God, it was so easy. And the motto of Cafe Coffee Day is, a lot can happen over a cup of coffee. And that day, really a lot happened over a sip of coffee, actually. But you see how easy it is for God to do things. But do we give time? Do we rely on Him till the last minute? And Elijah learned to wholly rely on God. The second point is from 1 Kings 18:42b to 45. Sorry, 1 Kings chapter 17, 21 to 22. My second point is Elijah daringly prayed for God-sized miracles. He was bold in praying for God-sized miracles. He was bold. And 1 Kings 17:21 to 22 says, 3 times he stretched himself out full length on the boy, praying with all his might, God, my God, put breath back into this boy's body. God listened to Elijah's prayer and put breath back into his body. He was alive. You know, he boldly prayed over a dead boy. It's over. But he boldly prayed for life to come into a dead boy's body. Are we resizing our prayers based on our limitations? No, in the aeroplane, when you have to watch something on the screen, they'll say, this video has been resized based on the screen. Many times, the way we pray, we resize our prayers based on our limitations. But can we trust and allow God to be God in our lives? Can we give room for God to do the miracle? When you read the story of Pakistan, how I made it to Pakistan, in my book, you will see it is purely God who did the miracle in how I got my visa. But today I want to focus on one story before I close. It's from Somalia. Somalia is known as a very dangerous country. First thing that comes to your mind is the pirates. And I asked so many people for contacts. Nobody knows anybody from Somalia. But God told me to travel to every country by 2010. In 2006, I was invited to perform on the cultural stages at the FIFA World Cup in Germany. During the week, I was performing at the cultural stages. But during the weekend, I used to go to churches to preach. One such Sunday, I was preaching in Hanover at the Calvary Chapel Church. And I was telling them how I was willing to live for Jesus and die for Jesus. I was close to getting beheaded twice in one of the countries, close to getting stoned. But God protected me. And when I went to these places, I always informed my mom and dad that there is no guarantee that I would come back alive. So I prepared myself. And that's when I had the total freedom. That's why I never checked the safety records of the airlines. I always check the price. If they offer me a cheap deal, I will take it. Even when MH370 went missing, next day itself I took MH because they were offering a very good deal. For me, there is no problem. I can sleep so well in the aeroplane. I can really sleep well. Once I was upgraded to a business class from Cincinnati to Paris, and next to me was a fashion designer from Korea. We wished each other and we slept well. Well, I went off to sleep. And after 8 hours, I was woken up for breakfast. I just got up, approaching Paris. I looked at this girl and I said, good morning. She said, good morning. And she said, you slept so well. I said, yes, I really can sleep so well. She said, yes, I saw you. You slept so well. It was a flat bed. Then I asked her, did you sleep well? She says, might be 1 or 2 minutes. I said, what's wrong? It's a flat bed. You could have slept well. She says, yeah, but I was so worried. What if there's turbulence? And I said, just because you're awake, you think the turbulence will be away from us? You have no control over those things. She said, you're right. But what if the plane crashes, if something bad happens? I said, if the plane crashes, at least sleep and die. This is not the way to die, by being awake. How many times we have put our worries out there without having one iota of strength to make a difference. So I've learned to put my faith in Jesus and to trust in this journey. But here, I had no contacts. So when I preached this sermon, at the end of the sermon, a family came to meet me. And they said, that was a wonderful sermon. Have you been to Somalia? I said, no, I really want to go. They said, we are from Somalia. It will be nice if you can go back and share the gospel to our family members. I said, I would love to, but I don't know anyone. They said, we can connect you. We cannot go back to Somalia because we have become Christians. And if we go back, we will be killed. But after hearing your sermon where you said you're ready to die, it will be nice if you can please go to Somalia and share the gospel to our family. Now, I can't tell them, please don't take my sermon out of context. It was very much in context, actually. So I exchanged emails, contacted the family members. Everything was going well, bought my tickets, got my visa in London. A week before, the parents were doctors, and he wrote to me saying, Benny, please don't come. 5 Christians' heads have been beheaded, and it's too dangerous. Don't come. I said, doctor, I'm sorry to hear this, but I have already informed my parents that I might be killed, so I am ready to come. He said, you might be ready to die, but we are not ready to die. Don't come. I said, I've bought my tickets. He says, we have already prepared to move to another city. We are sorry. We will not be there to receive you. The wisest thing from a human point, from an earthly point, is to cancel the trip. Because everything is negative about this trip. Everything showcases that God is not in it from an earthly point. But what is God's will? What is God's will? Do you allow your circumstances to define God's will? No. So I went back to Jesus. And I said, God, do you want me to go? He said, yes. I said, but I have no contacts. He says, I will provide for you. So I prayed for a God-sized miracle. I said, God, I have no contacts, but I'm going to trust you that you are going to provide a contact. And I sat in the aeroplane. It was called Dalo Airlines. Never take this plane. The aircraft is in such a bad condition. They have not passed any tests, but that's the only aircraft that takes you there. One wing, they have tied a rope, another wing, duct tape. You know, this is the last journey of your life. And we took off, and the steward came. He saw my guitar with all the flags. He said, and by the way, suddenly the plane started to go down. It's a 3-hour journey, but after 1 hour, it went down. So I told the steward, you know, why is the plane going down? He said, we have empty seats. We want to pick up some passengers on the way. And that is when the word Airbus made sense for me, because it just went down on a field, picked up a few passengers. People with AK-47 rifle escorted them. Everything was normal, except I'm not used to the plane going down, picking up a few people and going up again. But he looked at my guitar case and said, have you been to all these countries? I said, yes. He said, where are you going? I said, I don't know. Whom are you staying with? I don't know. What will you do in Somalia? I said, even that I don't know. He said, you're coming to the most dangerous country and you have no clue. I said, you're right. He said, why don't you play a song? So I took out my guitar, thinking that that is my final song before I meet Jesus face to face. And I gave my best. When I finished playing, he said, wow, you're a good musician. My friend Abdullah is the head of the media. Would you like to meet him? I said, I would really love to meet him. In fact, at this point, I'm ready to meet anybody, even a pirate, I'm ready to meet. And he calls up Abdullah as the plane goes down and he gets a signal. And he tells Abdullah about me. And Abdullah says, tell him to be there. I'm sending my driver. By the time the plane arrived and at the parking bay, I was the first one to get off the plane. And there was the driver waiting for me. And he said, follow me. He escorted me and took me to the hotel. Then next picture, please. And he took me to the hotel and he says, put your bags and come down. Abdullah is waiting. And Abdullah is one with a red and black striped shirt. And Bill from the United Nations says, Benny, tomorrow is going to be an amazing event. For the first time, the elite of Somalia are going to come. And we were looking for an international artist to perform. And nobody would come. Let's see how you play the guitar. When I finished playing a song, they said, you are the perfect person. Why don't you represent the international community to share your story and your music? I said, I'm sorry, I can't be there because tomorrow I have a flight to Djibouti. Then Abdullah says, why don't you go day after tomorrow? I said, I could go, but day after tomorrow, there are no flights. Tomorrow is the only day I have to travel. And Abdullah says, that's not a problem. We'll fix a plane for you. Now, how will you believe that in Somalia? I can't even believe that in India. But he said, what time do you have to be there? I said, 5 o'clock by evening. He takes the phone and says, cancel tomorrow's flight and rebook it for day after tomorrow. It was just fake. It looked scammed. So I looked at Bill and I said, Bill, at least you will tell me the truth. Tell me if this guy is genuine. He says, Benny, Abdullah's family owns the airlines. They can cancel the plane whenever they want and they can fix the plane. And that's what happened. The entire aircraft was canceled so that they could get me to perform there, share my testimony in an Islamic country like Somalia, and the following day I could go to Djibouti. This is God-sized miracle. This happened not because I was a pious guy. It is purely because I learned, one, to wholly rely on God, two, to pray for a God-sized miracle. And I pray that each one of you will have an adventure with Jesus in your own journey of prayer. My mother prayed for my salvation for all her life, actually, because I was a gone case guy. I was a broken mess, suicidal at 16. I planned my own suicide. Everything was done, but my mother prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed. My entire family is saved. We're all in the ministry. My father was the last one, scientist, the most difficult one to crack, but God did a miracle. And he's an amazing father. Mothers and fathers, please pray. More than counseling, more than this therapy, that therapy, everything, pray. Your prayers have power. God can do that. Just like the hymn they sang, let earth praise and heaven reply. Let your praise go up and let God respond to your prayers. And you will be a powerful witness. As a church, you will be a powerful witness to the world outside. I'm going to close by playing a song on the pan flute, How Great Thou Art. And today with the choir backing, I know that it'll be a heavenly experience. At some point, I will ask you to sing. And I want the choir to sing their heart out because they have the microphone. And I want you all to sing your lungs out because you don't have your microphone. And let's sing and praise God, saying, How great thou art. Let's play the track, please.
Thank you.
Shall we close our eyes, please? Loving Father, I want to thank you for your word, your timeless scriptures. Thank you, Lord, that you love us for who we are. Thank you, Lord, that we are created in your image. Thank you, Lord, that you are the only mediator between God and man. And we don't need to go through any other sources, any other subgroups, but we have direct access because what you did on the cross is sufficient enough for us to have faith in you, faith that you listen to our prayers, faith that you have the power to answer our prayers. Lord, just like Elijah, an ordinary human being, if he could fervently pray, give us the strength and the faith to believe that our prayers can be answered because of you, because of who you are, because of your greatness, because of your power, because of your love and your grace and your concern for us. Especially commit those who are going through a dark time, an uncertain time, a time where probably they're feeling that you are far away from them. Might be they're feeling very dry inside. They feel betrayed, cheated, backstabbed. I don't know, but you know your children. And Lord, I pray that this morning you would minister to them and that they would have faith and that they would passionately pray with intensity, a fervent prayer or an earnest prayer, and there would be a revival happening in each and everyone's life, that they will bear a testimony that our God lives and our God answers. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Benny, for the ministry of God's word and music. Indeed, our God is great. As we continue to reflect on God's word, let us give to the Lord this morning.
Can we close our eyes and continue in an attitude of prayer as we spend a little time on intercession? Dear Lord Jesus, we who are gathered here, your children, we come together at this moment to offer up to you prayer for each other, for every one of your children across the world. You have blessed us with the opportunity and time to be able to come to you so openly without fear, to gather as one and pray as one. And we ask, Lord Jesus, for the strength needed to be salt, to be light, to be your message, to be your child.
Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let your love increase. Lord, make us instruments. Of pride.
There is constant battle, constant war between nations, within nations, inside our very homes, and deep inside our own hearts. For those whose bodies and spirits are crushed by blood, by tears, by utter despair and mind-numbing fear, we pray, Lord Jesus, for your love, for your peace. For those steeped in thoughts of gain by any means, seething revenge, absolute bitterness, and also for those with a sense of self-righteousness and prideful humility, we pray, Lord, for your mercy and your love. For those whose faith is new and untested, for those who have stood the test and come out through times of turmoil, for those with unfathomable grit and love who actively take your name and your message to your children all over the world, we pray for your strength and your patience. For those yearning for release from pain in mind, in body and spirit, we pray for release and healing. For those blinded by the image that they need to portray, even spiritual, that they will be able to fearlessly come to you as they are, wholly and truly. We pray, Lord Jesus, for all people to see people as people, not as pawns to be played and manipulated for greed and lust. To see people as people, whatever titles or roles of power one may hold in this world, not as gods, but as created by God. To see people as people, not toys for personal gain and selfish pleasure. We pray, Lord, that you open the eyes of their hearts, open the eyes of our hearts. Help us to see through the dirt and the darkness with heavenly wisdom and discernment to be your message.
Green.
Lord Jesus, you have told us that in this world we will have trouble. But to not fear, because you have overcome the world. Love has already won. Help us to understand that peace is not the absence of trouble, Lord Jesus. It is the presence of you in us. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
It's the closing hymn for this service. Let us stand and sing hymn number 127. O worship the King, all glorious above. Hymn number 127.
Oh, worship the King.
As mentioned earlier, after the benediction, there will be points on screen, and I would encourage that the church pray today, every day this season for our nation, and everyone who can vote should vote. That's our duty, responsibility as citizens. So let's pray and be involved in the nation. Let's look to God in prayer. Almighty gracious God, we thank and praise you. For we, O Lord, are not just few in number. The world can call us minority. But Lord, when we think about the hosts of angels in glory and the church universal, what a mighty army of Jesus Christ. And what a joy it is, Lord, to lift our voice in worship. And not only, Lord, on a Sunday morning in this sanctuary, but every day, Lord, that we can enjoy sweet hour of prayer. We pray, O Lord, that we will experience this, not just hear the word, but live the word. We pray for our nation as the election's coming up. And Lord, as we cast a vote on Friday, we pray, O Lord, that you who hold the thrones of the earth in your hand, that Master, we pray for justice, peace, unity. We pray for the development of our nation. We pray, O Lord, that you will see the right person as leaders at various capacities. And we pray for our nation, Lord, that there will be a mighty move at every level, especially for the nation to know Jesus Christ. And so, O Lord, we come in bended knees, believing that our prayers are powerful because our God is powerful. To you be alone all the glory and honor. Bless our dear brother Benny, his wife, his ministry. We pray, O Lord, you'll continue to use him for your glory. Thank you, Lord, for this time. We love you. We praise you. In Jesus' name we pray and we receive God's blessings. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, love of God the Father, the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit be with each one of us now and forevermore. God bless every one of you.